Our speaker this afternoon really has always aspired to a career in communications. But early on, his career aspiration was to be a telephone lineman. He wanted to climb those poles and string those wires. That's when we usually actually use wires to communicate. Can you imagine such a thing? But all that changed as an undergraduate student at Western Kentucky University in Bowling Green, Kentucky, when he took a very primitive computer science course, and he caught the technology bug. And what a career Bill Tallent has had ever since then. He spent his 20 years, first 20 years out of college as an IT manager for Genesco. And for the last 30 plus years, he has created and operated and in some cases sold off a variety of entrepreneurial ventures and companies. Starting in 1995, he launched his current enterprise, Mercury Intermedia, which develops mobile apps and content delivery systems. At age 69, Bill Tallent may not look like a Renaissance man or look like one of the leaders of technology and in the news and information business, but indeed he is. His company, over the last 2 years, has launched 20 major applications for mobile media on Android and Apple platforms. 20 applications, major applications. 14 of them have achieved top ranking in their categories, and the number one news app in the country on the iPad for the last 21 months and counting is USA Today's mobile app. That is the work of Bill Tallent and his company, Mercury Intermedia. It's my privilege to present to you Bill Tallent, the founder and CEO of Mercury Intermedia of Nashville, Tennessee. Bill Tallent.
Thanks, Jack. Jack, you make it sound great. It doesn't feel quite that good working every day at home. Thanks for the opportunity to be here at the university. This is actually the fourth university I've been at in the last year. Interacting in the university setting, and particularly with students who so get it when it comes to this new medium, is very important to us. We learn more from these experiences than we impart, I'm sure. And thanks to you, Jack, for sponsoring us and making this possible here. We've been to three of the four Freedom Forum Centers, and we'll see in the next few weeks the fourth one at the University of Mississippi. Journalism, like many industries before, is experiencing a disruption that is reshaping its distribution of its product and the business model that underlies it. Today, I'm going to draw from lessons of other industries and from the early efforts of the journalism industry to harness the medium du jour to perpetuate journalism as we have known it. I hope to suggest, in the end, functional ways to skate to where the puck is going. A lot of you in the room, some not all of you, but a lot of you in the room remembered telephones that looked like the one on the left. They were all telephones. You could have any kind of telephone you wanted as long as it had one red button and five clear buttons. And they were all connected by wires, and we lived on those things. A lot of you will remember the cell phone you see there in the center. For those of you younger, that was a cell phone. And we thought it was hot stuff. It was hot stuff in its time. It really was. And then, of course, today we all carry the devices that you see on the right. Now, talk about a disruption. The telephone companies had billions and billions and billions of dollars invested in buried copper, still do. And are still getting some use out of it, although less and less every day. That industry experienced a serious disruption. They faced it. They didn't have any choice but to face it. and they are still adjusting to it. They adjusted their business model. Now, I'm from Nashville, so this is one that's close to my heart, the music industry. The music industry was going just great. They were making vinyl records, and then along came the CD. The CD was just great because that meant they could charge you $20 for one good song and 12 lousy songs. And they had a racket going with the CD. And then along came digital devices, the iPod in particular, and it upset that business, and they didn't face this change very well. They responded by trying to sue consumers and make headlines in doing so. They were just going to be sure that the CD was going to last forever. And the computer I gave my granddaughter to go to college with last week doesn't even have a CD player on it anymore. So we know what happened there. And in the disruption that I think has to be the sheer definition of poetic justice is these devices have disrupted the disruptor itself, desktop and laptop computers. These guys, the handheld ones and this iPad, have disrupted the computer business like unbelievable. You know, PC sales are down 20% this year, and they're dropping faster and faster and faster. Hewlett-Packard pulled the flush handle. They exited the whole business last week. They're selling their whole computer business. So even the disruptors occasionally get disrupted. Actually, what Jack didn't tell you was how this business got started. I started a digital printing company in 1990 to disrupt the analog printing industry. And in 1995, when the internet came along, it disrupted me. So I sold a printing company and started this business. So disruptions are not new, but they're happening a lot more frequently. They seem to be larger and larger. So, I've lost my place. Okay. So, what happens, I think, is that when you advance technology for its own sake, you eventually reach a point where incestuous thinking grinds advancement to a snail's pace, and enhanced competition begins to devour the inwardly thinking participants who gave birth to it. I think that's what happened to the desktop and laptop PC business. But when one sees that something is part of our larger culture, and one advances that something to benefit the greater good, culture as it were, the results can propel the visionary to unknown heights. Walt Disney did it in entertainment. Henry Ford did it in transportation. Thomas Watson did it applying computers to the enterprise, and Steve Jobs has done it applying computers to the broader culture. 15 years ago, when Steve Jobs returned to Apple, his industry was focused inwardly and participants were engaged in an incestuous arms race to see who could offer the most RAM or the most USB ports or the colossally largest hard drives, as if consumers saw their fundamental value in terms of their technological possessions. I call it unidimensionalism, an inward focus on their own art. Perhaps it was sheer brilliance on Steve Jobs' part. More likely, it's because Apple's back was against the wall 15 years ago, because they were facing bankruptcy. But in the past 15 years, Steve Jobs and Apple have ushered in an era of what I call multidimensionalism. He simply saw the industry not as an end to itself, but rather as a way to improve our culture. Just after the announcement of the iPad, he gave us a rare clue to Apple's view of a non-incestuous technological world when he said the following. He said, technology alone is not enough. It's technology married with the liberal arts, married with the humanities, that yields the results that makes our hearts sing. Nowhere is that more true than these post-PC devices that need to be even easier to use than a PC, that need to be even more intuitive than a PC, and where the software and the hardware and the applications need to intertwine even more seamlessly than they do on a PC. Now, let's repeat that last line, but let's substitute website for the word PC. Where the software and the hardware and the applications need to intertwine in an even more seamless way than they do on a website. That's the key to where we're headed. Just as iPads are post-PC devices, apps on the iPad are post-website content mediums. When he returned to Apple, instead of entering this technology arms race, he instead focused on the liberal arts and created not just a music player, the iPod, but he also created an ecosystem that would provide the music industry with a new business model to accompany the device. And today, though the music industry titans were drug along kicking and screaming in response to their digital disruption, they today use Apple's ecosystem to survive. Apple's competitors responded with their own devices, but without the ecosystems, resorting to their traditional technological methods of competition, and none of them ever put a dent in Apple's iPod business. They still have 70% of that business. So what does all this have to do with today's topic, disruption? Well, Apple is the latest example of a disruptor par excellence, and that Apple's disruption, that Apple's disruption offers profound clues for journalism. Now, we turn to the journalism disruption. You know, the telephony business had only been around 100 years. And the record business was less than 100 years old, but print, that's 500 years old. So the disruption we're seeing now is a disruption of a 500-year run. It's beginning to fade. So let's set the stage for a deep dive into the implications for journalism by examining why this device, why the iPad, has dramatically reshaped the computer industry. I won't bore you with statistics. You already know all the statistics about how successful it is. You already know that while the iPad isn't changing everything, it's changing a heck of a lot. But people are simply mystified, baffled by the iPad's success. Barely 2 months ago, a major executive from Microsoft and another from Dell in the same week publicly embarrassed themselves, opining that the iPad was a mere fad that would soon pass. So let's unpack the success of this dramatic, I call it a fourth generation computer, after mainframes, mini computers, and microcomputers, or PCs as we've called them. I call this really a whole fourth generation of computing. Let's unpack this transformative success and see what has made it successful. The first thing is that it simply simplifies life. On one of these devices, we can hold our newspaper, our business documents, our entertainment, our television, not just our book, but our books, a small library of books. 3 years ago, if you were standing on a commuter platform in New York waiting to catch a train to New York City, you had newspapers under this arm and a briefcase in this hand. Today, it's typical to see someone standing there with an iPad. It just simplifies life. People have always paid to have their life simplified. My grandmother did. So this is one of the keys to the success of that device. It's a simplifier. The second key is that Apple always builds ecosystems around their products so that everyone can live. It's a key part of this device. They built an ecosystem so that the music industry could survive. The movie industry is surviving on that same ecosystem. The journalism industry is already benefiting from the ecosystem that comes with these devices, even though there's been a heck of a hue and cry over paying 30% of it to Apple. Nevertheless, it is an ecosystem that enables journalism to perpetuate itself. The same for the entertainment industry, etc. Next, and this one's really important. It's not an isolated product. It's a member of a family. So if you're thinking about whether to buy this thing, all of a sudden you say, well, considering the alternatives, look at the iPad. It's part of a family. It connects to a computer, a Macintosh computer. It connects to an iPhone cell phone. So you've got the computer, you've got the iPad, you've got the cell phone. They're all part of a family. And guess what? This fall, the cloud is going to, Apple's cloud, which is free, is going to orchestrate them all. It'll keep them all up to date. I got to tell you, last night, putting this finishing touches on this talk today, and connect, then every time I would change my slides on my Mac, I would transfer them over here to the iPad. What a pain in the neck that was. This fall, when Apple's free cloud is finished, as soon as I hit close on the Macintosh computer, it'll send it up to the cloud and it'll come right back down and automatically install, not just on my iPad, but it'll also install on my iPhone. So this is a family, it's a family, and it just makes sense. And one of the reasons that iPhone sales have picked up, you may not know it because all the press is about Android sales, but iPhone sales have accelerated. One of the reasons is when people get an iPad, they think, well, why shouldn't I have the iPhone that is coordinated with it? And it's actually, the iPad is actually boosting sales. Next, they built an application ecosystem. Jack told you that I go back in computing to the 60s when I graduated from college. In the 60s, IBM dominated the mainframe computer business. There was nobody else out there. You know how they did it? They went out and got applications written for the IBM computers. There were so many applications available for the IBM computers, so few for the Sperry UNIVAC computers they competed with, that the IBM selecting an IBM mainframe, well, you just did it. There was an old saying, and it was very, very true. You never got fired for buying an IBM computer. It's because it had this application ecosystem around it. So what Apple did in building an application ecosystem for these devices, that was not rocket science. They really copied what IBM did back in the 1960s. But there are so many applications of every description for this device, it just makes sense to buy it. Superb engineering. You can't overlook that. That's not what Apple is all about, but their devices are engineered really, really well. What's not to love about a 12-hour battery? I left Nashville at 5:30 this morning. At 10 o'clock tonight, this iPad will still be running. A 12-hour battery, my God, is just awesome. Two simple plugs, an earphone plug, and a plug at the bottom. Oh, the critics just ate them alive for that. Where's the USB plug? Where's that plug? Where's the Ethernet connector? I mean, my God. And Apple simply made a superbly engineered, simple, simple, simple device that works. It's interesting. The competitors to the iPad are all focused only on this step. They're out there competing with the hardware and trying to emulate the form factor. They forget all the life simplification features of this device. They forget the fact that it has a huge application ecosystem. So people like Hewlett-Packard come out with a, actually, I really love the Hewlett-Packard touchpad and the Hewlett-Packard handsets and everything. I thought they had a shot. They put them out on the market, and about a couple of months later, they go out of business. And not just out of business, they decided to get rid of their whole computer business. So competitors just aren't showing up for the iPad. They're getting no traction at all. There is one indication here that one company out there may get it, may be catching on, and that's Google when they bought Motorola last week. It seems to be that Google is figuring out that you need an end-to-end ecosystem of software and hardware, and who knows, Google may get there. Now, this isn't a reason for the iPad's success, but it is a reason you're going to see a heck of a lot more iPads in your future, and that is they are enormously profitable. Now, I think a lot of companies could have produced the fine hardware that this device is. I mean, it's truly fine, and it's commendable that they produce such a terrific piece of hardware here. But what's astounding is they did it at a 41% margin. It is enormously, it is obscenely profitable. Dell's operating at a 17% margin and teetering on going out of business. Apple is working on a 41% margin. Last quarter, they put $10 billion more in the bank. They're up to $76 billion now. So not only have they put together one hell of a device and a great system around it, they're making a pile of money doing it. So you're going to see lots more of these. They today dominate this whole supply chain, making it so much more difficult for the competitors. So you can't hide value from consumers. So when you put all these things together, the consumers look at the iPad and say, well, at $5.99 or $6.99, it's a hell of a value. So it's no wonder these things are selling like crazy. The success, in my opinion, is rooted in the triumph of multidimensionalism over unidimensionalism. They didn't just focus on creating a netbook. They never went for that problematical. They never went in that problematical direction. They rethought it and took on a whole new direction and built a multidimensional system. Its designers thought first about how it could improve our culture. Hence, today, they can run that great television ad. I think it's one of the best TV ads I've ever seen that concludes with, we will still do all these things, but how we do all these things will never be the same. And that's a great TV ad, and it's because of what they've been able to do. Now, what to look for ahead? Apple's going to pour more gasoline on the fire. You're going to see more devices, more screen sizes, more platforms. I have a question mark, and I left my comment from the last presentation on there just to keep myself humble. HP looks promising. I just put a strike through. I just wanted to show you that I'm not as good as Apple. I thought HP had a shot, but they didn't. Now, big question. Will Microsoft respond adequately and in time? You know, I don't know. I have no idea. I don't know how to handicap that one. I think Amazon is to be watched because Amazon can produce an Android-based iPad-like product, but Amazon can make it part of their whole purchasing system. Amazon's got a shot at being successful here. What about Samsung, who basically is just a copier? I'm not so sure about Samsung, whether they have a good future. you can expect a deeper penetration into family life. Two or three iPod families are now common. My daughter's family has three, and they use them constantly. A deeper penetration into the enterprise. I got to tell you, IT managers would never willingly bring an Apple product into their company, but they didn't have any choice when it came to the iPad because the CEO brought it in and told the IT managers, this is a transformative device. You need to get busy with this. And enterprise has gone nuts over the iPad. I cannot tell you the kind of demand we're now getting from enterprise, people that use PCs and desktops and laptops to interface systems are saying, why can't I use a touchpad? Rewrite the front end for a touchpad. So on top of the typical mobile demand, we now have enterprise demand. Hundreds of thousands of more applications, and I ask the question at this point, is the website an endangered species? Horrence, can you imagine to have asked that question only 2 years ago? Why would any, I mean, my God. But look at this chart. June last year, the average minutes per day for consumption on websites, the websites are green, was 64 minutes, 43 minutes. For apps, and a year later, look what's happened. We've already had a crossover. We're already spending more time on apps now than we were on websites. You could never, if someone had told me that 2 years ago, I would have said, well, you just must be, I want some of that, some of what you're using. And look what's gonna happen just this year. Just this year, between iPhones, iPads, and Android devices, there's going to be another 250 million devices shipped this year. And by 2012, shipments of touchscreen devices will exceed PCs, and we'll begin to see the switchover. Now, I argue that disruptions can be anticipated. Mostly they're denied. It's hard for us to accept it. I mean, if you think about journalism, most of us, I grew up with a newspaper and ink on my hands. You know, it's hard for me to ever think of life without a newspaper, and I think it's hard for an industry to think about life without the newspaper, but the journalism industry has, I think, confused journalism and news with the paper medium. And I think that we can think past that. They can be managed. They rarely are. These disruptions happen faster and faster, but they can be deciphered and solved. And ultimately replaced with a new business model. That is what's happening in journalism. The business model is in the process of a complete shift. The same economic underpinnings of the business model that supported a business that revolved around newspapers is going to be very different than the businesses you guys are going to be running. So let's take a quick look now at how people are using the iPad to consume news. And this, by the way, these slides came from Roger Fidler's, I'll get it here in a minute. There we go. Came from Roger Fidler's surveys. He's done two now at the University of Missouri. Now, remember, the people surveyed here are the people already using the iPad to consume news. 94% are satisfied with their iPad, 70% very satisfied, 62% spent more than an hour a day. Now, here's a big difference between the iPad and the iPhone. This device we keep with us at all times and use it all throughout the day. This device is used primarily at home. It's used in the mornings and in the afternoons. Here's an interesting one. 62% use it between 30 minutes and 2 hours a day for news consumption. That's a big one. 32% use it 1 to 2 hours. That's a lot of time with an electronic device. Here's a biggie. 93% are more likely to use this in a newspaper's website. Okay, lots of money and lots of time have been spent on websites, but people are moving away from websites. And of these, 72% are somewhat more likely, and 93% are the difference, 21% are extremely likely to use an app instead of a website. Now, this is an interesting one. You can't see that left scale very easily. 3, 4, and 5 is likely, somewhat likely, and very likely. And the more time you spend, the more likely you are to cancel your newspaper subscription. So these things are catching on, and this is just going to continue to grow. So that's where we are, and let's talk about now where we can go. Now, I'm going to take you through some facts that are happening out there, and those facts are drawn from these brands. These are the brands where we've developed applications, some iPhones, some iPad. And even we've done a Microsoft Windows Phone 7 application for the New York Times now. So lots of data behind these facts, 30 million downloads, a billion user notifications sent a year, and 35 billion stories a year sent through our systems. On March the 11th, the day of the tsunami, that tsunami hit in our time here after we had breakfast and before we got really to work. And mobile devices really carried the news that day. And just the systems that we operate, we carried 250 million stories that day. One of our customers, Fox News, put out two breaking news notifications on the tsunami. And their servers served up 1,000 stories a second for 22 straight hours. So these numbers are absolutely enormous. But here are some facts that we've drawn from this. The average length of an iPad session is over double the length of an iPhone session. Now, a lot of these are comparative statistics. And the bottom line of all these comparative statistics show that although this guy got the attention early on, this guy's winning the war in the news business. As a matter of fact, I was at a customer last week, and they said, what's the first application I should develop? I said, hands down, an iPad application. Well, but there are more people out there using the iPhone. Yeah, but they use it a whole lot less. This is the winner at this point. And here's one of the reasons. Sessions per day are about the same. Now, since this device is used mostly at home, this device is used throughout the day, I expected to see a lot more sessions off this device than I did this. In fact, they're roughly the same. Time of day patterns, I referred to that a couple of times on the left. The iPhone, as you can see, we use it all day long. On the right, the iPad, we use when we use the newspaper. We use it in the morning, and we use it when we get back at home. Now, the average user, if you look at the minutes per month, they use 75% more minutes on the iPad. Now, you know what a CPM is? That's the rate per thousand you get from advertisers. On the iPad, you can get 5 times as much as you can on this device. This device, you can sell ads for about $10 per thousand impressions. This device, you can get between $50 and $150 per thousand impressions. But let's just say 5x. Let's just say it's only 5x. So let's say you can get five times more. So when you put those two together, iPad usage is double the iPhone. iPad CPMs are five times the iPhone. So it's a no-brainer. Since an iPad can generate 10 times the revenue of an iPhone, it's a no-brainer to build an iPad app first. So we've concluded that iPads are increasingly a more serious competitor to newspapers themselves than the smartphones. And in fact, in this year, everything changed in this year, and one of our major newspaper customers, iPad installs alone are 115% of the sum of iPhone and Android installs. So you see, the iPad is really taking off. One of the talks I made earlier this year, I was asked, do they garner new users? Do touch computers garner new users? Well, one of the major newspapers now has touch computer readers that are double the number of readers of their newspaper, and they're 12 years younger on the average. So it's pretty easy to reach the conclusion that the market for news was a hell of a lot larger than the market for newspapers. So it's hard for me to get depressed when I think about the problems that newspapers are facing, because I can't do anything about it to start with. But you got to think, the market for news is a whole lot bigger than newspapers were already reaching. There are 23 people in my company. I'm the only person who's ever subscribed to a newspaper. Why did we go into making news apps? Well, because our guys said, we can't get news that we like. We'd like to develop a news app that we would use. That's actually why we got into the business. So it's a big market out there for news, a lot bigger market than we thought. A few random facts. Android tablets not yet gaining traction for the reasons that I pointed out to you. Android phone installs, I know they get all the press, but in terms of news product installs, they've declined by 66% recently, and they're now less than the iPhone. That is a huge switch from what was happening in 2010. Rim BlackBerry, when we got into this business 3 years ago, we would get calls for Rim applications. We hadn't had a call for a Rim application in 2 years now. So Rim is no longer a factor in this business. And the Windows Phone 7 is not a sure thing. It may be successful. I don't know what to tell you about that. It's a nice piece of hardware, but being late getting into this game, wow, that really does handicap you. I understand there are up to 30,000 applications now, which is pretty impressive, but still, nobody's buying the phone. So I don't know whether they're going to be successful or not. Okay, now, we're finally to the point that I wanted to talk to you about, skating to where the puck's going to be. And that is how to build a best-of-class application. And the applications that you see out there, that you see on your iPads and your iPhones right now, there are some of them that are fairly good, but they're by and large not nearly what is going to win the game over the long term. I want to talk to you about my perception of the kind of applications that are going to make journalism successful in the future. First, they're multidimensional, not unidimensional. You would not believe how many early newspaper apps simply attempted to take the newspaper and put it on a touchscreen device. Okay, that's okay for a first effort, but some of them are even now doing replica editions. So help me, the biggest problem I've got with one of my customers is their replica edition. I asked them, what in the hell is a replica edition? They said, well, we just take a PDF of the newspaper page and put the PDF over on the news app. I said, so people will have to go around like that? Yeah, that's right. That's not the kind of application that's going to last very long at all. And neither are those that mimic the website. Neither of them are. This touchscreen devices are a very new, very different medium Well, let's go a little further. Best of class applications will all have breaking news notifications. Breaking news notifications drive traffic. And what you want to do is drive traffic. You didn't have to think about driving traffic except when you were in the newspaper business. You went to various community events and put up a little booth to sort of boost your circulation. But circulation changes were really small when your medium was ink on paper, not with this medium. With this medium, you can stimulate the heck out of circulation by doing things such as breaking news notifications. Social features, I can't even think of a newspaper app now that doesn't have social features that enable you to share stories, and it builds the brand. It encourages other people to download the device. Now, extensive in-app links. You wouldn't believe how many applications now you can hyperlink on something in the application and it closes the application and takes you somewhere else to a website page usually. Gets you out of the app completely. When I say in-app links, I mean links that do things but keep you inside the app. For instance, if you're looking at a list of the bestsellers, the best-selling book list, you ought to be able to touch one and read a review right there inside the app. When you're reading a review of a new record, you ought to be able to listen to an excerpt. You ought to be able to execute a purchase right there while you're inside the app. That doesn't sound like a newspaper, does it? It's a very, very different medium. Box scores, when you're in the sports section, you ought to be able to go to box scores, and if there's a game in progress, you ought to be able to find out what's going on in that game right now. It's a given that applications have got to have offline modes for subways and poor reception areas. This morning, before I got on the plane, thank goodness my USA Today app had an offline mode, and it was downloading every story as quickly as I opened it so that when I got on the plane, I could read all the stories still. On-demand and standing search. By that I mean an on-demand search simply means you should be able to key in a term and search what's on your app right now, but you also ought to be able to enter a standing search. If this is about the Boston Red Sox, any story about the Boston Red Sox, I want it saved for me. You ought to be able to do that as well. The next big area that we're pursuing in apps is delivering what we've always talked about delivering and we never have, and that's highly personalized news. Jack is a skier. Jack is going to be wanting, Jack, what I'm sure would love to know as we get toward the fall, he'd love to have ski conditions on his favorite three resorts sent to him. These kinds of things are possible with a new class of software called middleware, and they're not more than 6 months away. But really, truly personalized news. One of the reasons, for instance, I never turn on breaking news notifications is because I don't care what happened to Britney Spears. But if I had a way to get breaking news notifications that I wanted to hear that made sense to me and that would filter out those kinds of breaking news notifications, I would use it. So highly personalized notifications, highly personalized news, it's going to be the next big step here. Number two, provide superb user experiences. If you don't hear me say anything else today, I want you to hear me say this. The most important thing about the app is the user experience. Now, the first thing. Write it in a native language, not HTML5. Now I know HTML5 is all talk. Financial Times of London did a very decent HTML5 application. If you're an iPhone owner, if you own an Android tablet and you go to that application, you're going to say, "Man, I don't understand how this works." But for iPhone owners, they did a decent HTML5. So we're getting asked by that a lot. It boils down to this. If you want the best user interface, you're going to use native programming, not HTML5. Now, If you want to know more about this, we've written a 5-page white paper on this subject. Be glad to send it to you. Also recognize that, like so many things in life that become political arguments, well, I have Macs. Well, I like PCs. Well, your Macs are toys. Well, your PCs are stinky complicated. You know, there gets to be a political nature in some of these things, native versus HTML5. It's a political argument. It seems like we always want to take sides. Well, I'm for the Red Sox, you know, so I'm for the Yankees. So there's a political aspect to this argument, but it boils down to superb user experience. If you care about user experience, you'll use native, not HTML5. When I'm talking to my newspaper clients and we get to this subject, I typically ask, well, do you print color? Do you have color presses? Well, of course I've got color presses. Well, do they display more news than the black presses? Well, of course not. They display the same news the black presses do. Well, you know color presses cost 6 times as much as black presses. Why do you have color presses? Oh, yeah, I get it. Okay? So user experience and the advertiser experience. Next. This is my pet peeve. I love to pontificate on this one. Are designed by specialist designers with an intimate knowledge of touchscreen users. I want to tell you that most dynamite graphic designers out there can't design their way out of a wet paper bag when it comes to these apps. You might be able to design the prettiest page in history, but unless you know how these devices are used, unless you know it intimately, unless you know the conventions that Google sets for Android apps, that Apple sets for iOS apps, unless you understand how they work, you cannot develop a good user interface. And it is so important to have a design person who is good graphically. There's no doubt about that. You need someone good graphically, but you need to have someone who knows these devices if you want a good user experience. Never let your designs reflect consensus. I guarantee you, you'll have the worst user experience in history if you work for a lot of organizations are consensus-based organizations, and that's okay, but if you try to develop an app with consensus thinking, it's going to be an absolute disaster. You need to leave the design in the hands of someone who can fairly represent the brand, but who knows the device. Never try to replicate web page designs. Realize that touchscreen users, to a large extent, are trying to escape the poor UXs of websites. Websites are probably the worst user experiences. They had devolved into some of the worst user experiences. For instance, when I went to a news website and touched on a story, I could bet I was going to have to go to 5 different pages to see it so they could show me more screaming obnoxious ads on 5 pages instead of 1. Okay? Websites had devolved into bad user experiences. Don't translate those bad experiences over to this device or the same thing will happen there. If you've got a good design, you don't have to instruct the user on how to use it the first time they open it. Have you seen those sites where the first time you open an app, it gives you all these instructions? It's not very well designed if it does that. Don't underestimate users. Apple knows that, and we all know, we've all got our stories, that people from age 2 to age 90 can pick up the iPad with no instructions and use it. Do you know, I had a customer last week, so help me God, this is the truth. I had a customer last week that fought us on the main navigation page. They wanted to put the word home on it. And I said, oh my God, not only are you going to make people think you're back in the 90s and the days of home pages when we used to talk about hits. Do you remember when we talked about hits to a website? Way, way back in the dark ages. Don't underestimate users. They get it. Even if you don't, users get it on these devices, so don't insult them by hitting below them. I was talking to Todd coming in from the airport about this one, and there's really only one thing to say. Video is required now. You may be a newspaper without a video tradition, but you're not going to go very far in this new medium without video. If you don't have video, you got to figure out some way to get it. When breaking news happens, you should see the difference in statistics from our print-based sites to our video sites. All the traffic goes to the video sites, and the print-based sites, they get left behind. So this is just like guts for openers. You've got to have video. Now, this is one that I'll be surprised if you've even seen before. The best applications going forward are those going to be served by a new class of software called mobile middleware. Now, mobile middleware is software on servers that stands between the content source and the devices, and it's used to accelerate content delivery, to insulate users from content problems, and those of you that are going into the journalism business, I can tell you, content problems never stop. You can't kill them all. Thirdly, they assure high levels of uptime. Our servers, we think we're failing if we fall below 99.95% uptime. It's just a demand, and they search the news. This is where the search is done. If I want to know something about general dynamics, this is where that search gets made, because no phone and no iPad is powerful enough to filter down at the device level. It gets done at this level of middleware, and it's going to require this level of middleware to deliver the kind of news applications that are going to be successful going forward. Now, just a few tips for managing the development process. Get the content feeds perfected before you begin development. I have one customer, we built an app for them a year ago, and it's still not live because they can't lick their content problems, their content feed problems. So I can't say enough about this. This does more to derail launch dates than any other single thing, content problems. You got to get them fixed up front. Don't rush the development process. Everybody, once they decide to build an app, they want it yesterday. Everybody does, and they will push and shove and do all sorts of things to get it fast. It takes 120 days to develop a quality app. Can you do it faster? Well, of course you can do it faster, but that's on average the time that you should allocate, 120 days to do a good app. Now, there are three things I want you to remember about development, the three most important things. And if you don't hear me say anything else today, hear me say this. Why? Good design results in high user ratings. High user ratings result in frequent usage, high retention rates, high engagement times, which means more ad views, which means more revenue, which means more success, which means more apps, right? Okay, you've got to be able to have a great user experience. You remember back in the website days, we talked about hits, and that meant nothing. Well, our term like that here in this business is called downloads. Oh, I've got 10 million downloads. Well, that's really impressive. How many did you retain? How many people came the second time, and how many people are still coming? It's the retention that counts. It's the downloads that you retain and keep. You do that by providing great user experiences. Now, I think I'm repeating myself now, aren't I? I think I'll just slip that one. Build to maximize revenue. Realize you've got to have a great user experience, you got to have a great looking app, it's got to have great content and all that, but really the only reason, the main, most important reason for an app's existence is to generate revenue and build to maximize revenue. Now, this one may sound strange to you, and there may be one or two exceptions to this, but not many. Users won't pay for a brand, but they will pay for quality content delivered by a quality application. They will absolutely leave your brand for somebody else's brand if you can't deliver on those two things. What's an app cost? Get asked that all the time. Budget $200,000 to $250,000 for a good app. Invest wisely, don't spend frugally. What in the world do I mean by that? I mean that when people first started building apps, they looked at apps as an expense. And they said, how low can we go? How cheap can we get this app? And so the cheaper they got that, and I'll give you a great, I can't say it because I'm on a webcast. I can't say who it was. One of the great news organizations of this nation was first out there with apps. They beat everybody to the punch. They did the cheapest apps they possibly could. And as long as nobody else was there, they got great ratings. The minute other apps came into the market, they went to the seller where they today reside. Okay? You can build a cheap app, but you can also relegate yourself to no usage. It is important, I think, to think of an app expenditure as an investment, the very same way you think of a printing press. For after all, apps are going to replace printing presses. So you've got to think of them as investments. So what you want to do is achieve the lowest cost per retained user. Think about that. It's not the lowest absolute cost, but it's the lowest cost combined with the highest utilization. Because at the end of the day, the only thing that counts is how low is your cost for each user you get. So it doesn't help to have a low cost if you get no users, in other words. So think of it as an investment, just like you would a printing press. That's what that slide says. Now, people in the industry are worried about ad revenues and circulations being down for newspapers. Well, there's some good news, too. The good news is that while revenues are down, distribution costs are down a hell of a lot more. Look at this. An app replaces a printing plant, delivery trucks, paper carriers, and the cut you give the local newsstand. You can replace all of that with an app. You're going to replace with hundreds of thousands of dollars of expenses, tens of millions of dollars that you're spending today to print newspapers. So you're going to have to come up with a new business model. It's true. Advertising revenue on touchscreen devices isn't as high as it is on newspapers, but neither are the production cost. This is an important transformative new medium. It is going to change journalism whether we want it to or not. So my recommendation is take it very seriously and invest very wisely. So I'm only 3 minutes over. So I'll leave some time for questions and answers if you wish. It's up to you.
And we would ask that people go to the microphone so they can be heard statewide as well.
All this silence. I guess I left no room for questions.
Bill, how do you view Steve Jobs' resignation? What's that going to do with Apple?
Yeah, that's a good question, and here's how I see that. Walt Disney is a fabulous company today, and it has and it's because that company still has Walt Disney's DNA. Ford still has Henry Ford's DNA, and there's just many examples. What a lot of people don't know is Steve Jobs hired, I believe it was a Harvard professor, but he hired a professor some years ago and established Apple University to inculcate into that company his values. And I think that company has his values in their DNA, and I think they're going to do great. Now, that said, Steve Jobs, I've been studying businessmen. I don't know why. I've just had this interest in businessmen ever since I was 14 or 15 years old, and I've read more biographies on businessmen than I could count. And only one have I found really excites me as much as Steve Jobs. You know who that was? It was Cornelius Vanderbilt. And Cornelius Vanderbilt, of course, was one of the greatest entrepreneurs of all times, doing commuter sailboats and steamboats around New York and then railroads, and built. When he died, Cornelius Vanderbilt was worth $1 out of every $8 in circulation. That guy was really wealthy. He made Warren Buffett look like a piker. So I think Apple is going to do great, and I just think he's one of the greatest businessmen that we've ever watched, and it's really sad. It's really sad to see him go. Our guys were at WWDC back in June, and they got some seats down on the second row, and they said they really wish they hadn't gotten so close. So, good question, though.
Bill, you're on a university campus the day before the start of a new fall semester here at the University of South Dakota. What advice do you have for the students of this university as to what they should study over the next 4 years plus? And what's your advice to the faculty to prepare these students for whatever the new reality is going to be? I mean, you could predict, today you offered some predictions, and you could only go out about 6 months. So what is it that should take place at a university like this that is trying to launch careers and you know, embrace the liberal arts?
Yeah, it's a great observation you made that with all my predictions, I went out about 6 months. You know, this whole thing caught me flat-footed. I thought I'd seen, with PCs, I thought I'd seen all the computers I'd ever see before I retired. I had no idea. I mean, when this thing came out, I said, well, this is a cool way to make money in the cell phone business. And they put some apps out for this device. And I said, what a cool way to sell cell phones. And then they came out with the iPad. And I said, oh, my God. I can see where these guys are going now. They caught me completely by surprise. And it's hard for me to predict where it's going from now, but I know this, that all my predictions now are short term. It's hard to see. So what do you do if you live in a world like that? You prepare yourself to do as many things as you can while you're here. But the most important thing for you to hear from me is that when you leave here, you continue to prepare. And you to continue to prepare. You study more things. You study as many things as you could possibly cram into your brain. And the more prepared you are, the more equipped you will be to see an opportunity when it swims in front of you, and know when it swims in front of you that it is indeed an opportunity, not just another fish, and know how to jump on it and do something about it. In the kind of world we live in today, there is no answer other than relentless preparation. Now, you're going to do that in the next 4 years here, and your faculty, I don't have much advice for the faculty other than to put in front of these students the broadest possible perspective, or the broadest possible set of perspectives that you can, because none of these students has any idea of what is ahead of them. And they need to be able to be prepared to make all sorts of shifts throughout their life. For instance, when I set up, when I got that printing business going, I was proud of it. We went from a startup to the 73rd largest printing company in the country. Now, that doesn't sound impressive till you realize there's 12,500 printing companies out there. And we did it in 4 years, and we were really proud of that. I mean, really feeling great, and then the internet came along. And I was about 2 years too late getting out of the printing business. I should have sold that business 2 years earlier. But at least we started this business, et cetera. So you have no idea how many shifts you're going to have to make, how many changes and directions you're going to have to make. And the only way to equip yourself is to study as many different business subjects and study as many liberal arts, study the humanities, because Steve Jobs has found that it's the combination of those things that have made Apple, as of Friday afternoon, the biggest corporation in the world. 15 years ago, they were bankrupt. Friday afternoon, the biggest corporation in the world. And he did it by a combination of lots of things in our culture. He didn't get focused just on having well, they replaced the USB with a Thunderbolt port. Well, that's not going to do anything for Apple. But putting together a device like this that's culture shaping does. Oh, good question. That's the best way I could answer that one, Jack.
You mentioned that highly personalized news is going to be a big step in the future.
Yes.
How can that always be a good thing to isolate yourself from other bits of news where you may not want to read Britney Spears, but what if all I read was Britney Spears?
Yeah, I hear your question, and you make a good point in your question. And it flies in the face of what I was just talking about staying broad and preparing yourself for lots of things. But at the same time, to be aware of everything is to be aware of nothing. Sometimes you want to focus in, and personalized news lets you focus. One of my new customers is SAP, the big German software company. So they've got salespeople, and they're specialized in four or five industries. And I think one of them is the aerospace industry. I'm not sure, but I think it is. But let's just assume it is for now. And you're a salesperson out there, and you're calling on aerospace industry clients. Then it helps you do your job better if you can get a filtered flow of aerospace news in addition to whatever else you're doing, okay? And by personalized news, that's what I mean. We're building an app for SAP employees so that the salesperson, before he goes in to call on an account, well, let me give you an example. I was with SAP last Thursday at Hilton, the hotel company in Washington. It would help those people to be able to pull up all the news about the hospitality industry before they go in to make that sales call. It's a good question you posed, because you don't want to isolate, but at times you do need to focus. And it's to help those people that want to focus. If you're in public relations and you have 10 clients, you want to be able to automate the search for every piece of news on those 10 clients every day to help you do your job better. If you are a concert flute player, you know, that's another way that you can sift. There's so much news out there, and there's so little time. It is really helpful if you can have a digitized assistant in the background doing the sifting for you. Good question, though. I hear the implications of that.
Could you talk to us a little bit about the future of paywalls in some of these new news apps?
Yeah, I should have spent more time on that. The future is what you make it. But if you don't make a future for paywalls, you're not going to be in business. And here's the reason. The price of everything is based on supply and demand. And in the case of electronic advertising, the supply is infinite. And you know what happens to rates when the supply is infinite. So whereas I did say accurately that the iPad's getting $50 CPMs today, they're not going to be getting $50 CPMs a year from now. So advertising rates are sort of fickle, and you're going to have to get, just like your current business model calls to be paid for a subscription or to be paid for the paper at the newsstand, it's going to require that same business model, in my judgment, to be a viable news organization in the future. I admire the New York Times for stepping out and taking a bold stand, and the others like them that have, and not enough newspapers are. All of our new customers are putting up paywalls. I encourage them to do that, and I help them do that. Absolutely essential.
You'd mentioned print and kind of print journalism. What impact does it have for broadcast journalism, the iPad, radio, and TV, do you see?
Give me just one second, please. Patience, please. You will work. Hey, I'm pretty relaxed when demos mess up. My first demo messed up in 1967. Think about that.
Blame it on the connection.
Years after being convicted of sexually assaulting two young girls.
Live television.
He was freed from a Scottish prison 2 years ago. Now the man convicted of bombing
Pan Am Flight
103 over Lockerbie.
We did this for CNN last month. We're doing it for Fox News right now. And television is not just for television sets anymore. And television is going to be standard. In fact, it's already standard. By the end of this year, it's going to be standard across all networks on these kinds of devices. One of the things that I'm, that most of my customers not only have multiple newspapers, they have multiple TV stations, and I'm encouraging all of them to integrate the news from both of them in creating apps that they both can be successful with. Another answer to your question, on Thursday I was at the Washington Times. The Washington Times, what they have to sell is a point of view. It's a point of view that's the opposite of the Washington Post. And their editor's very well known for his Fox News type point of view. They also have a radio station right there on the edge of the newsroom with a personality handles the microphone at that radio station. We're putting them together in the same app, so that you'll be able to get that radio station. With our Fox News TV app, you can open it up. It has a radio tuner in it. So radio tuners, TV tuners, newspaper, it's all blending together, you see. That's what I meant by multi-dimensional news apps. And whereas in the past, we've had these walls. Okay, oh, the newspaper guy sit here, the radio guy sit here, the TV guy sit here. Well, we're very quickly moving to an era where they're all combining together into one stream. So it's essential that they do. So big impact.
I have a question that relates more to community journalism, and specifically like a small town newspaper. I'm thinking of our local community. We have a weekly newspaper, and I see where the newspaper business has been devolving since sometime in the early 1980s, you know, less and less readership, that sort of thing. What does what you're talking about mean for those small newspapers that sort of provide that community forum for a smaller community like ours or others?
Yeah. For those sized organizations, we desperately need applications like the big ones can afford that are plug and play for a small one. Verve Wireless is trying to do that. There are some companies trying to do that, but when you talk about a $250,000 to $300,000 app, that's tough on a small community newspaper. So the answer is apps with the same capability for the big ones that can be inexpensively reskinned for additional newspapers. We're currently building apps like that, but we're building them for enterprises. The latest business that we have added is news for enterprises. So we'll build a news application for Megan. Sorry, I had to turn the sound on so you could hear CNN. We're building apps now for big organizations that want internal news apps. And we will combine commercial news, that example I gave you a while ago, like you may want to focus aerospace news to you because you're selling the aerospace industry. We're combining that kind of news with company news and creating news apps. Guess what they don't have? They don't have editors. And they don't know anything about editing. And this is a hot field. Everywhere we take this app, this enterprise news app, people will just say, I want it right now. So there's a huge demand. You're going to see a huge business build for enterprise news. And schools like yours need to think about educating editors that not only aim to work at newspapers and broadcast stations, but editors that also work within enterprises to help shape news for the enterprise. So that's one of the things I'll want to talk about when we get into the classroom discussions tomorrow, but I think it's going to be a big news field.
First off, welcome to South Dakota and Vermilion. And I'm curious, you mentioned the HP touchpad a couple of times early on in your presentation, and I'm wondering what glimmer of hope you saw in it, and did it have anything to do with Adobe Flash and in its interactivity? And do you think Apple will ever acquiesce and sacrifice battery time for the ability to use Flash on iOS devices?
Yeah. I personally hope they don't. I hope they never give in to Adobe because they make terrible software. It not only burns your battery down, a lot of our developers have had to stop, listen to this, they've had to stop receiving PDFs from outsiders because PDFs are so virus ridden. That is a company that's just not on the dime. They're not with it. Their software is not good. It destroys your batteries, and I don't think Adobe is going to get it fixed. So I hope they don't ever do it. What I saw in the HP touchpad was terrific software and a good user experience. I loved the user experience in that product, and the product they actually brought to market was not a very good product because the processor was so slow that you could actually run the HP software twice as fast on an iPad. The super techs can figure out a way to run it, and it ran twice as fast on an iPad. So they missed it on the hardware side, but they just had a great user experience. And the other opportunity I saw is HP owns retail shelf space in every retailer in the world because they sell printers. And I saw them with that shelf space is giving them a huge advantage for getting their product in stores all over the world that other people couldn't. So I saw that distribution advantage as a plus as well. But the touchpad acquisition, the acquisition of the Palm software, was the last guy's acquisition. The new CEO's been there only 6 months, and if he stayed much longer without doing something, it was his acquisition, so he had to either kick it or it would be his forever. So he moved out of the hardware business, and I don't know that I can fault him, because there are no margins in the hardware business anymore. So yes,
Bill, I get the honor of asking the last question, because we're okay. Just about out of time for our web stream. If you were going to start over today in any industry, which one would you choose?
I choose computers. It's been a good industry for me. It's I've been in other businesses. I've built men's clothes. I built sport jackets like this for a living at one time, but I always came back to technology. Technology is what's reshaping everything. It's what reshaped the music industry. It reshaped the telephone company. It reshaped the PC laptop industry. It's reshaping the television industry right now, and that's where I see the opportunity is, and that's where I see a good portion of your all's preparation needs to be.
Well, thank you very much for sharing your expertise with USD.
You're welcome.